Hey everyone, welcome to Artist Decoded episode number 58. I'm your host Yoshino, and in this episode, Artist Decoded New York affiliate, photographer, and host of the Walking Home podcast, Michael Donovan interviews Brian Shevlin, founder and owner of Con Artist Collective, located in the Lower East Side in New York City. So the Con Artist Collective is an artist community, creative co-working space, and gallery founded in 2010, and they are an active community of creatives curating group shows and social events. They also actively encourage creatives to collaborate on projects and network within the space. And when Michael first told me about this space, I got really excited because this is something that every community with a large community of artists should have. And I love how a group of artists doing different disciplines can communicate in a shared space and build a positive working community environment to uplift the arts community. So I think something like this space is really important, and I think these guys are doing something really, really cool within the artist community. If you like to check them out, go to www.conartistsnyc.com. That's conartistsnyc.com. So go check them out. We'll also have images of their space on our website, artistdecoded.com, www.artistdecoded.com. Also, AD and Con Artist Collective are putting together a deal for their space for the month of December. If you'd like to inquire about that, please email us at info@artistdecoded.com. Music for the podcast is by Rare Bit, aka Justin Hopkins. Research for the podcast is by Isaac McBride, Connor Duffy, and Ryan Kevin. So here it is, episode number 58 with Brian Shevlin of Con Artist Collective, interviewed by Michael Donovan.
Real quick, because this is the thing. So I talked to Yoshino, so he has this podcast, Artist Decoded, and I explained what's going on. I was like, we've got to do something with Con Art. Like, this is crazy. Can you explain to people that aren't familiar? I'm sure you've told a million people at this point. Like, even as people walk in the door, I think I've heard you say this like
spiel
10 times a day. Sorry for putting you through one more time.
No,
you can just do this and press play when people walk in.
I know. Actually, I make an effort because, you know, we've been around for 7 years. We opened in 2010. And so you repeat yourself so often that at some point, like year four, I started hearing my own like draw recording voice, you know, like,
yeah, you like were able to step out and
hear it. And I'm like, can even have like conversations in my mind while I'm talking, you know? Yeah. And so actually I made an effort since then to like try to always think about how to describe it today, like right now, this minute, because it is sort of an evolving space and project. So I kind of make an effort to actually like have an organic description of it, so I don't go into like repeat speak, you know, like go into like automated robot voice.
But
we opened in 2010, and it's an art collective. And art collective is sort of a complex idea because people are like, what is a collective? And, you know, I get the easiest way I like to describe it, it's like a co-op versus a collective. A co-op is sort of like implies you cooperate. So you both operate, you both own, or you both are 100 people or whatever. A co-op is a group of people who own something and operate it together. And a collective is like the same thing, but I don't need to operate it and own it. Like somebody owns and operates it. I'm just part of it, you know? So it's an art collective, and really an art collective, like any co-op, is just a group of people who like want to share a thing, like a house or a grocery store or a park or whatever, right? And so it's an art space. So it's an idea that a bunch of creative people want to have access to all these creative things. And so we've slowly grown with like realizing one of the number one needs for creative people is workspace. So somewhere to work, somewhere to paint, somewhere to build, to create. As well, what happened soon after that, a year or so after that, we added a gallery, because after you make your thing, you want to be able to show it, you want to be able to exhibit it, and that's actually really hard to do as well. So we grew into like the gallery, then that grew into a store. So that's when we started selling prints and pins and stickers, and then that grew into like this virtual community, because people really wanted to connect and meet each other and wanted to engage in projects. So we use like Yahoo family groups and all these things. And eventually we built a private social network. So basically year seven, what it's really grown into is this 3,000 square foot venue of a bunch of creative people who want to connect. Con artist means connecting artists. That's kind of where the name comes from. And share a space, share equipment, share a gallery, share a community. We do events, we do projects. Now we work with other galleries, we work with art fairs. And really at the end of the day, it's just sort of a tool or a service that a creative person might engage with to like get to wherever they want to go in their creative pursuits. So
it also has this weird factory type feeling to it, because the characters that are in this, and I want to get into this too, because and before we get into that, maybe we can talk about too how you started it personally, right? Because this isn't something that just, again, you explained it didn't happen overnight, but you kind of came from, you were like hustling on the side.
Yeah, I mean, well, my background is all over the place. From like, I opened a graphic design company when I was like 20. I worked for a skateboarding magazine for many years and a recording magazine. So I always had like a pretty big creative background, I guess. But I would have never, everyone shies away from calling themselves artists. I definitely fell into that group a lot. And now people even say like, oh, well, you're an artist. And the truth is, I like to say, no, I'm not. Because really, I think an artist is somebody who's making art, whether it's like that minute or whatever. And I'm actually kind of, I haven't made anything creative as art for a long time. So actually, I really do run a space, but my background has been very much in the service and in the industries of creative and artist. And so working in restaurants, working in management, working in this background of like operations, owning my own businesses, being an entrepreneur, all that kind of led to this big idea that I've always had forever, which is like, how do you have this like space, this venue where like all kinds of creative people can like work together or like share or connect or just do rad stuff, you know? Like, and really, I grew up in the 80s and 90s, and through the 90s, this whole zine revolution started really kicking in. And for me and a lot of my friends, my grandparents owned a printing press, which was a really unique thing. So at the age of 15, I was like working in a printing press. I mean, for my grandma. So, you know, I was going in after school. And my friends, we would come over, and back then we would, you know, have our blue pencils and, you know, photocopiers and wax, you know, cut things out of paper and like wax attach it to artboards. And then we'd shoot those and create plates and use these AB Dicks, these like single color presses, and like run off zines and all kinds of stuff. But we'd all be hanging out in the room together and like cutting and passing things back and forth. And that kind of collaborative-y environment of like working on projects together, I think really stuck with me about like how I really like having creative people connect, you know, and like be around each other. And like, some of these guys were graffiti guys, some of these guys were like photographers. They were all kind of related to skateboarding, because it was sort of through my background in skateboarding and working in a skateboarding magazine, or in bands. Everyone was in a band too. I'm from Northern California, so everybody was in a band. But anyway, so that's a long, probably too long description of this background of like that led me to working in New York and working in management and restaurants and running places and operations, that kind of made me decide one day, man, maybe there is a way to do this as a business. You know, how can I start this as an actual, instead of this rad thing that would be cool if it existed in some utopian society, like maybe there is some way to create this creative space, you know? And then, you know, I'd been to like art residency programs, and I think a lot of that was some influence, and schools are a really big influence. I just didn't really like teachers and scholastic programs, you know? I didn't like the structure of a classroom. Like, for 3 months, you're going to focus on this subject and that's it in this room, you know?
Yeah, so I always feel like rescuing those kids. You know, it's like I have this intern and she's going to SVA, and I'm like, oh no. I'm sure it's great. It's great for some people, but totally. Then it's like, just go shoot.
It's also just one of the many ways we as humans learn. It's just one way to learn. And, you know, I think.
But there's this pressure to do that one way. Like,
totally. And it's actually, like, sadly, it's sometimes considered like the only, like, it's like there isn't a lot of other choices. Like, oh, I don't really learn this way. Oh, well, you're screwed. That's the only way. You got to get this piece of paper after 4 years and put it on your wall.
Well, it's even funny too, because like someone is listening and they hear your story, like about your Was it your grandparents at the printing press? Mm-hmm. Yeah, so it's like, oh, my grandparents didn't, so I guess I can't do it.
Right.
You know what I mean? Because it's like, well, Brian did it that way.
Right.
It's the only way.
Well, you know, part of that was just really luck. I mean, what was cool is like, I think it just made me comfortable to be at Kinko's. Because then later, like when I was in my 20s.
That's a great skill. I'm comfortable at Kinko's.
Totally. I just would walk in and just, you know, like back at Kinko's in the 90s, if you remember, it was like, you just walked in there. It was sort of like the
there was something about that. There was something. I remember like, I was in yearbook. And so I would still like, you end up hanging out at Kinko's. So,
yeah, you just hang out there all day.
Yeah.
With that big table and and the paper cutters and the scissors.
And then like the business people would come in and they'd like all stand in line while you're just fucking making a mess.
Totally. You just take over the place. And a lot of times
they'd have the markers, the highlighters, and like mine now.
Totally. Totally. And actually, you know, I was always pretty like, as a person, I'm always like, oh, of course you can borrow that. Of course you can. Yeah, sure. But, you know, I had some friends who were like, particularly these like skateboarder graffiti guys, and they were like, people were like, would come in and they bring their own supplies and they'd like just go over and take their supplies. And like, can I, you can use it when I'm done using it. Like, but I brought that. But anyways, you know, so Kinko's was sort of this space, but actually, it wasn't the fact that like the printing press was a resource that like, offered me an opportunity which was unavailable to anyone. It opened the door to a world to me that I don't know if I would have walked in on my, I wouldn't have thought to ever, like how a printing, like, because when I was a kid, I'd go to my grandparents, it actually was a copy shop, they call it like Charlie's Copy Joint in Sacramento. And mostly they made like wedding invitations and business cards and flyers and like little booklets and
catalogs. Which sounds like the least cool place for a kid to hang out.
Totally. Oh my God. And it smelled really bad too. Yeah. But what was funny is somewhere around the age of like 13, I would go there and, you know, I was really into coloring books and stuff like that. You know, I was always a really big drawer. I drew and colored. And so I would go in there and there'd be like, just like part of a catalog that they're printing. Like actually, there's one strong memory. Some sort of reason they had like line art drawings of cars, right?
Okay.
It was like basically a coloring book. I mean, it wasn't. Yeah. That wasn't the intention of this thing. And they were like, there'd just be thousands of them. Like, you know, because they would run these multiple colors and test. And then you actually have to, you'd run off the presses to dry the ink off of the plates. If you've ever worked in one of these little AB Dick single color things, you'd have to run it off to kind of clean it. Then you pop off that plate, the paper plate, and put it on a new one, which is the image that you're imprinting on the paper. So they would literally run off like thousands of copies. They have these stacks and they run it back through them, and you didn't put double prints and upside down prints and like, you know, all the mistakes. And I was always really gravitated and drawn to that. So I just go through those like garbage piles, start coloring them and then I go and play with the stapler. I think part of it was like just being a kid and like wanting to do something fun and while you're waiting. Cause my mom, you know, I was like 13. So my mom worked there a little bit and whatever, I'd be stuck there sometimes. And actually my grandma would pick me up from school and like, so like, hey, I'll give you $20. I think it was probably like $5 actually. This is the 90s. I'll pick you up from school and you can help collate this like thing and I'll pay you X amount of dollars. Actually, my grandma was really jealous. It was probably $20. And so, you know, I'd go and do that, but then, you know, it'd be like hang out and they'd be on phone calls. And so it'd just be playing around and I would color and do that stuff. And so anyways, I think that's when it like something clicked and went, wait, I could take my own drawings. And like, what if I like shot those and ran it off in blue and red and double printed it and triple, you know, like these like, and it was before the idea of like knowing that like people did that, you know, like there was a zine revolution and DIY and all that was actually happening in this huge punk movement that was, everyone was doing it. It was more just, I was like a 13-year-old, 14-year-old kid at the printing press looking at it. And it was like the ideas popping in my head. And actually when I made my first zine at like 15, I didn't even know anyone else really did it.
Isn't it weird though too? Because like, it's almost like, this is a conversation I keep having recently, especially here. It's like, you get these ideas that kind of whisper through, and then if you're tuned in, you can hear them.
Right.
You know, it's almost like, it's almost comical. Like for me, hanging out here, it's like, people are like working on something like, you could do this, you could do this, you could do this. Because someone else is going to do it if you don't do it. But these ideas kind of float through it, even though, like, why was it happening somewhere else in the world? And then why were you connected to it?
Right.
It's like, because it was doing it.
Right.
And it happened to like kind of push itself through you to be like, hey, Brian,
There's all these spiritual things. I think actually the printing press, someone out there who's listening to this can Google this, and I'm probably full of shit, but there's like, I think the printing press is one of those things that was invented like on two places in the world at the exact same time. Like, right, okay. You know, right around the same time. Like there's all these people go to these like spiritual ideas that like what you're talking about, once the idea seems to be in the air in the universe, like we can all kind of tune into it. There's like some sort of like zeitgeist of like this like weird dream, like idea zone of like these radio waves that people like communicate with each other subconsciously through or something.
Anyway, I totally believe it. There's a lot of people
who believe it hardcore. And then there's just people who like, well, I don't know if I believe it or not, but it sure as hell happens. History has shown that it's definitely happened, but, or people like, I don't believe anything. Yeah, and they're Trump supporters. No, I'm just kidding. So, anyways, let's try to stay away from politics.
I can't even do it anymore because it's like, well, you know what's funny is that I got burnt out because I came in here the day after and it was, you know, the whole city was fucking depressed. Like all of New York was depressed. And then I come in there, and then of course the conversation is about this. And then this is a beautiful thing. Then you have people sitting there making their art about it immediately, within seconds, you know. And you see it. You see immediately how quickly artists jump on this thing, and they're politicizing it, and they're making their posters, and they're making all this crazy shit. And then you got to give it to like Brandon and Boris, who are definitely going to have. conversation that's going to fill a room.
Totally.
Love them both. And then with all that, then after like 36 hours, like, I can't anymore. I can't be near it.
Well, I mean, that actually goes into answering some of these other questions that we started talking about, which is that like when you're in a community space, these topics that are going on in the world always end up being potentially like a discussion, like there's something to talk about, you know, even if it's like, why are you eating what you're eating? Or guess who just got elected president? You know, when you're at home, people often can work alone and work at home and you can be very productive. I'm not, you know, I own a co-working space. So I definitely, obviously I'm always, you know, promoting the idea of working around each other. But the truth is too, is all humans, whether people are like, oh, I'm an introverted person. It's like, it's true. But, you know, it doesn't matter that if you're introverted or extroverted, that being around other people, hearing someone say something, that's just, you know, a lot of ideas come from it. So it was hard to be at home.
That was an interesting thing is once I came in here, it's like, it was like this accelerator. It was, and then, because the other part that you end up working, if you don't work from home, if you're not working in an office or a co-working space and you're working from home or you're working from a cafe, and the cafe experience is terrible because you're looking for Wi-Fi, you're looking for a place to sit, a place to plug in, you know, this whole thing. Plus, you're an artist, so you've got shit that you're trying to do that you're like, I don't want them to see that, you know?
And people are like sitting down and spilling coffee on the table and, you know, wipe it down.
Yeah, there's like a stress kind of thing. And I walk into it now. I walked after I did my first day here and I walked out and I walked into a cafe. I'm like, I will never do that again. You know, you just felt this like zombiness of like this frustration, like, happening.
And there's also like an energy of a room, you know, it's weird. Like I actually talk about like, I think there's a really interesting thing about a bar, right? If you go to a bar and you think about it, like when you go to a bar, it depends on the type of person you are too, but a lot of times you walk into a bar and if there's no one there and it's like, it's kind of quiet, like you don't want to drink there. But if you go to a bar and there's like activity, like this place is happening, this is really fun. You're not going to talk to any of these people. It's like, but you need them to be having fun near you for you to want to be there, right? And it's funny, it's just to me, a bar is a really clear example of like how sensitive we are to the energy we're looking for the place we want to be around, right?
Yeah, because it's like when you walk into one too, and it's like, that's not for me.
Totally, yeah.
And you have no idea why. It's like you're walking into four different dive bars, they all look the same. Yeah, it's not the same.
Totally, or you walk in, maybe you're like, you're kind of like a dive bar guy. Let's say like this is Lower East Side. So let's talk about the Johnsons or Iggy's or these types of places. And maybe that's your scene. And then you accidentally with a friend and like, hey, let's go in here. And you walk into the Soho House, right? And it could be packed, but you're like, no, I am not hanging out with these people, right?
Or the flip side is like, oh, I will never do a dive bar again. You know, it's like, fuck that world. This is my life now.
Totally. And it's just weird. It's like, I'm not going to talk to one person in this room probably, but I don't even want to be around the energy that they exude. I mean, you know, that's not what a lot of people won't say that, but that's clearly kind of what we're doing, right? anyways, it's kind of this like cheesy little, you know, anecdote or whatever, that they're like, as a creative person in the same way, like our office environments, the way we set up our home office, like whatever, like we're really, you know, like the dog in the room or not in the room or whatever, like we're really, you know, sensitive to these types of things, particularly when you need to, like, being creative is a really stressful process usually for a lot of people, especially if you're doing it professionally, you know, and like, it's like, you know, needing to perform. You're like, wow, I don't want to suck. I don't want my stuff to be crappy because I hate being crappy, you know? So anyways, I think we're really sensitive to, so it's really important to have like an energy to the space. And so I think that's why like people do like finding their co-working space or finding a place where they can go in and like, these are my people, like the bar, this is where I want to be.
Yeah.
And then I don't think a lot of people, until you do it, until you actually like, it's sort of like, so again, to go back to that bar, if you drink alone at home, it's not a whole lot of difference to like drinking at a bar in a physical thing. You're consuming 3 alcoholic beverages and you're whatever, you're like hanging out by yourself or whatever, but drinking at home alone looked at publicly, like, oh, I just stay home alone every day and get drunk. Like, you have a problem.
Yeah, yeah.
You're a detriment. Like, you're a bad person in society. Not a bad person, but you know what I mean? Like, you need to fix yourself.
Someone with their drink in their hand broken right now. It's like, oh.
Yes, you need
that. You don't even know, man. Fuck you.
Anyway, I'm being a little judgmental, but these are dumb anecdotal things.
It's all good.
But then if you go into a bar and you have 3 drinks and you're like, whatever, and you're talking to the bartender, wait, you're there by yourself because you need to get out. And you're like even sketching on your sketch pad. Like, it's fine. It's actually, yeah, not only that, it's like, good, you're getting out of the house. You're like going and connecting. Anyways, all those are, again, that's just another way to say like a space can be so, it's funny how we look at people and how they interact with those spaces, those energies. And that's why I think for a lot of creative people, finding, this podcast isn't meant just to promote the idea of co-working, but you know, I do,
well,
think,
no, I do think it's valuable,
big about our space too. Like, what we do at Conrad's Collective is like to create an environment that attracts a DIY type of person. There's a certain type of demographic we believe is that type of personality. And it really is a personality more than a person, you know, it's the kind of person who's going to do it themselves. They're going to make it happen themselves. And they want to like, they might share an idea or share or like help someone else out, but they're also kind of like in their own zone and they're making it and they're following their dreams and they're following their passions. And whether it's their big career choice that's going to change their entire life or it's something they do on every other Sunday to like get away from their husband and kids or whatever, you know, just as like it doesn't really matter. It's just really about the space being conducive, a tool, really, a service or a tool to that person be able to walk in and be like, all right, this is my place. This is where I'm going to do this thing, you know? And I think, again, like that anecdote of the bar is like, if we do it right and you walk in, you feel that energy, like, I want to be here. It's just, it's hard. Like, that's when we win. That's when the place. So that's kind of the idea of the Conrad's Collective, is really to create a venue for that. And then it has a ton of stuff that goes with it, you know, like podcasts, like, you know, or gallery shows or events or Art Basel is going on right now. And I think there's like 10 or 15 of our artists all out there. I guarantee last night, a bunch of them met up at a certain bar. They're like, oh, Conrad's Collective members meet here. And they're all getting drunk somewhere. And, you know, it doesn't really have anything to do with the venue anymore. It's about, you know, this a group. It's a really,
yeah, valuable. I think that's the thing, what I kind of want to talk about, because there's parts that we, because there's so much to, I asked Yoshino, you know, I was like, how long do we have? He's like, 45 minutes to an hour. I'm like, it's going to be a fucking hour. He can't, no. I'm like, you know, I don't think you realize like what's in this, you know, this is, because he also, was, it's something he wanted, and he wanted to do something like this in LA, and that's why also I want to talk to you about the LA thing as well. But before we get into any of that stuff, I want to also just briefly talk about like the space itself, just for people that haven't been in there. There's a basement where you can screen print, you've got easels, you've got tons of tables. There's just like one of my favorite parts is like, well, here's just this big pile of paints and whatever the hell, use whatever you want over here. It's right.
It's like free, the shared supply corner.
Yeah, and it's just, and then it's like, it's just full of shit. It's just like,
really, tons. It is actually just full of shit.
Yeah.
No, but there's a lot of rad stuff in there. It's actually fun. It's like you can just go there and make art out of that corner all day long.
Yeah. Yeah. You can get lost over there, and you don't have to worry about, like, if you spill something, it's like, well, just clean it up because the table's already been spilt on like 1,000 times right. before. So you don't have that preciousness of home. Mm-hmm. You don't have totally. To like, you know, and it, you know, definitely feels like some 1980s, 1990s space of like, yeah, just do your thing, man. Like it does. I brought a makeup artist in the other day, you know, just to show her. And she's like, oh, yeah, this is you, man. This is fucking you. This is like Weirdville yeah. in the perfect way. Like,
I love that when you go down there, there's people in lab coats, goggles, and like rubber gloves on. And you're like, wait, what are you doing? You know, like, but it's true, like, you know, it is a place. I mean, it is true. That's really important to have a place that you feel comfortable. You can get messy. Now, hopefully the rule number one is you pick up after yourself because yeah. you don't want to walk up to someone else's literal mess. Have to clean up, but
glitter. No,
exactly, glitter. We've actually almost outlawed it because it really is. Glitter is the herpes of the art world.
Yeah,
like once one person walks in the room with it, everyone's got it.
I saw glitter out today, and I'm like, dun dun.
It's true. Like Ian, right? And Ian's so awesome, and you know,
yeah. he sees glitter,
one of the most talented people I've ever met, and yeah, he'll just come up to me. And he's got this look on his face. He's like. Oh, yeah, Brie was here earlier. You probably have glitter all over one of your drawings now, don't you? I'm sorry. Well, yeah. that's a struggle of a shared space, too, is like there is like you... It's funny. People talk about like socialism, right? And I don't want to go back into politics, but...
Well, this is what I think is interesting because you do have a space that... Yeah, go ahead.
It is a shared place and you don't own it, right? Nothing's yours. Even your own work in it has to be like... You know, it's in these like shared drying racks. And so someone else can fuck up your shit, you know, and it really sucks. And we have very strict rules against it. But, you know, hey, these are artists. People trip. People bump into each other. You know, it's a real world. So anyways, so we, you know, we have a ton of rules and we actually have full-time cleaning staff. We're cleaning this place all the time. We try to keep it as organized as possible. And we have new ideas about how, oh, now that we've ran this for 7 years, I think I have a better way... a system that's better to make it better for protecting, you know, so glitter doesn't end up on things. But anyways, back to glitter, we've almost outlawed it. And a lot of art places don't allow glitter for that reason. Because once you open glitter in the room, you're just going to find glitter on everything. You'll be in the shower, like you'll be on the second floor, right? We have two floors. So you're going to be on the main floor on your computer. You leave and you're like, why do I have silver glitter in my hair? When that, like, yeah. Why is that going through the drain? You're like, just someone opened glitter in the room and now you have it. It'll be on your pillow.
And you know what I think about too is I think about how much glitter is inside of our bodies.
I wonder. Actually,
you know, it's probably like yeah, I was just thinking too. It's like when the mortician like cuts us open, it's just this beautiful gold, silver, rainbowy, glittery, massive organs and fun. Like, you're welcome. Maybe that's like a thing. Like if not, I would never encourage anybody to commit suicide, but if you do it by glitter. And then it also it spreads with everybody who comes in contact with you.
Yeah, it'll be a fun thing for the autopsy person. Like, oh my gosh.
Whee! And then all the bodies for the next week will have glitter on them. Maybe just drive around like in your car with like open glitter. So if you get into a car accident, just like boom. So the ER is covered in glitter. Yeah.
This is what I love about like a social community thing is like, I love how you just spawned a million ideas of like morbid glitter concepts in my mind.
Well, and I gotta say this too, that's what I think is really fun about this space like this is that it's you know, there's other spaces that are out there. So like I visit friends that are at WeWork and they're like in their glass cages and super echoey and stuff, and I get it, that's like a perfect space for them.
Totally.
And then there's places like New House. Mm-hmm. Like I mentioned to Brad, I was like, hey, you know, for some of your clients, you might want to go to New House. Like, you can do like an afternoon thing. They have like a after five
right.
social for
totally. That's when you take your black jacket off and you walk around with your I was going to say your champagne in a plastic glass, but maybe it's really real glass.
Probably real glass over there. Yeah. But you know, like every space has its own thing. But I think being in the art space, there is something, you know, outside of art school or, you know, your friends or whatever, it's hard to find a place where, I mean, the conversations that we end up getting into, it's like, all right, we're going to just spend the next 30 minutes like people yelling about race.
Yeah.
and then it gets into like really interesting spaces. You know, the other day when we were talking about that, we talked about the difference between judgment, being prejudiced and being curious, like how much that will shift. And you know, it's a weird dynamic too, mm-hmm. of having artists in the room, because you do have a lot of people that tend to be more open-minded as well.
Yeah, and then plus people are like more okay with just like, I'm really in the middle of doing some really important work right now, but I'm going to engage in a 3-hour discussion about the difference between judgment and difference between curiosity.
Yeah.
Or what a prejudice, right?
Like, yeah.
But anyways, yeah, I mean, actually, but all that I think is important. For us, a struggle is the size of the venue and how exactly workspace interacts with social space, interacts with all these things. And as we've grown and as we grow, we have a lot of ideas about how we create, you know, this goes into a whole nother topic. So where I'm going with what I'm saying is I did a bunch of research with my architect who are members of the space. They actually run a small architecture company out of the space for years. So it was awesome to go to members and say, hey, we're building out a new aspect of the space as we expand. Because this is kind of like our third iteration of Carnes Collective. We're on Suffolk Street and we moved back, and then we doubled our size and took over the main floor as a storefront like 4 years ago. So when we built that out, we were researching like the offices of Google, obviously. And we were researching actually I thought a really interesting one was, what's Steve Jobs' other company?
Next.
Yeah. Anyway, some of those other
Apple.
Yes. When he was pushed out.
I thought that was Next.
Next. And he was also involved with something else.
Oh, he had a third one.
I don't know if he owned it exactly, but anyways, so we were researching, and all during that time, particularly, there was like how you design your office is conducive to a type of culture, right?
Yeah.
So one of the things that I thought was really interesting was that they actually, at one of these, and I think this is someone else, Google can fact check this, but one of the ideas of the office was they actually realized that there's a, the high level executive top people run the company. And down to like the janitor is literally in most buildings a physical divide. The bottom of the building, literally in the basement, and where the janitors are, right?
You work your way up.
As you work your way up
to that glass ceiling.
Totally.
To the top. Right?
And it's funny how the metaphor is so really true in a weird way. And so you end up with this idea that the people above you are kind of like, they tell me what to do. And the people below you are like, oh, the people below you, right? And so they actually decided to change up the office, and they were totally like right when they put right next to the bathrooms, all the executive offices on the first floor. So they basically force people to bump into each other because people forget that all these people are just humans. We're all just actual people.
Yeah.
So like when the janitor is pregnant, you know, and she's X far along, and the executive CEO is pregnant, and they run into each other at the same line for the bathroom, they're like, oh my gosh, how far along are you? How far along? And before you know it, like you forget, like, oh wait, these top level executives and these low level employees, we're all just people. And you know, and so anyways, they rethought the office, and it changed the dynamic of that company, right? And it's funny how the way where you place things and where you put things and will change how people interact and how people bump into each other and how. So anyways, a venue can, by its design, can force a culture or can encourage actually a culture.
Yeah.
So that's where that was my long diatribe to get to the point is we actually really did a lot of research into what we wanted to do with the venue. And I'm really sensitive to like the direction anyone sits and the direction of the room and where the tables are placed and how far they are from each other. And the sound of the room and we did all these fun things with it. But now that we're growing, I've realized there's a lot further we can go. So we've got some ideas on expanding, and we've been talking and really close to potentially opening another location. And there's a lot of excitement about that.
Here in the city?
No, probably in another city. It's really exciting. And once we can confirm it, I can't wait to say, but we'll go back to that design company. We've got a lot of ideas on how we can continue to improve on the idea of the space. Carnes is really awesome. But like anything you know, there's always, like, it doesn't matter, even my favorite restaurant, right? Like, I'll go in and I'm like, oh man, I just really wish they did this, or I really wish it was like this. You know, there's, so I love what we've done and it's great, but now that we can do it again, there's definitely some changes. And part of it is what you're kind of talking about how we can kind of like encourage social spaces that encourage the social dynamic, and then encourage kind of more of like workplaces that more encourage the like more working dynamic. And I think it's really important how they interact, but definitely the two can be a little, there's actually the rule, co-working space rule number one, put on headphones, put on big headphones that everyone can see. It's like, if I have headphones on, please don't interrupt me. Please don't come up and like start talking to me.
It's funny though, too, because you end up really not with nothing on. It's just a guard. That's the best part. It's like, it's a guard. In case there's a good conversation, you can like
take them off and jump
you
right
take
in.
One ear out and like, oh, what is this? Didn't hear the previous 20 minutes, but I know everything.
Exactly. I was gonna say, the best part is when somebody like Maria or whatever, she's got headphones on the entire time, and then like 30 minutes in the conversation comes on, I was like, you know what, I have a lot to say on this subject. Like, you were just sitting in the corner listening the whole time with your headphones on. You actually
weren't. Well, then the other funny part about it too is that and again, it's not like, I have some friends that are in these like entrepreneur type spaces, you know, that are very, you know, they're very geared toward that, but because this is such a weird mix of people that are literally doing DIY, and then you'll have a commercial photographer next to
but that's also a nice thing about con artist is sort of, it's a small space, so the community is kind of forced to be small. And I think that's something that we're definitely very aware of and engage with, that the size of the community. I don't know if you've heard of the Facebook number. I can't even remember his name. Someone else needs to Google this again. But anyways, that Facebook number is this idea that tribes and people kind of have these circles of like the max amount of people you can know, kind of. And once a community gets big enough, it will start to basically divide, because it doesn't want to be big. Like, people don't want to be in big, big groups. It gets, there's something unnatural to, or whatever, you know. And so the Facebook number kind of supposedly supports and proves that. And I do think there's so much truth to that, that once a community gets big, it wants to divide itself, right? It wants to start attacking the other side and like create cliques and break it to smaller divisions. And so I think the con artists is a really, and we were aware of that. And actually, I think it is like the third circle or something like that. It's like 100 people, like acquaintances or something like that. And so we built a space to accommodate like that third circle, that number. And I think that's actually been really good, because having a place that no matter X amount of people kind of can be in at any time means that you kind of, at least no matter who they are in the room, they're always within that, you know, to that level, you know? And so there is this kind of small community to it, you know, and actually Connors is about community, you know, it means connecting artists. So that's really the whole spiritual purpose to the whole thing, is to create community.
I'm curious too about, because you know, it's like, it's been 7 years, but it's only been 7 years, you know, it's that
seven
funny
years of, is a, like if all entrepreneurs tell you that's like a really important year.
Yeah.
That's like the year where you decide to like blow up or die.
Yeah.
It's like the two choices you got.
And it sounds like you're just deciding to blow up.
Well, we've been trying for, I mean,
you're talking about a second location in another city. I mean, that's not like, well, this is us dying. We're going to die in another city.
Well, I mean, I
want to make a third ward joke there, but.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, third ward was a wonderful thing for a lot of people in New York for a long time. And I learned a lot watching it, you know, but we're definitely extremely different than actually everything. It's really, I mean, everything, of course, everyone's like, of course, my donuts are really different from the donuts across the street, but,
it's legit different,
but it really is sort of, it's really hard to describe. It's something, and that's why it's kind of tough. That's why as a business model, it's been a little rough sometimes, because it's hard to sell something that like, all right, it's like, you can't even picture what it is. So it's like a new sport or something, and you start comparing it to like other sports, like, but until you play it, you don't know, it's a totally different game.
I mean, what I was going to say is like with it too, it's like you're probably seeing art movements happening too, or like you're in touch with the zeitgeist of the art world, because people are coming from so many different sources. Like, you have to be seeing movements happening or going or
I think that's such a wonderful, that's again, it's in a wonderful part of being part of like a creative community, is that there is so every day somebody walks in the door and they're contributing their tiny thing, or their, or it may even be a giant thing, but they're contributing their personal energy to like this thing. And that could be a huge trend going on with creativity, or new idea that's blowing up, or it could be even an old idea that's being recycled or rethought, or even, it doesn't really matter, but it's amazing. And it really does give you like a, what's it called when you have a fake environment that mimics the real environment?
A surrogate?
Yeah. It is like a surrogate. Maybe it would be I'm thinking of another word, but anyways, it's like a tiny little mimicry of what could be happening in the entire art world, or all of New York maybe might even be better. You know, it's like this little kind of like miniature potential sample, right?
Yeah.
which isn't necessarily always correct, but it actually is really cool because you do get a lot of insight from that. And another thing that makes me really proud, and one of the happiest things I can say, is that there's been 7 spaces that have opened up through us. So people come in. I love this, that people come in, they get involved and there for a while, they meet a bunch of other people. And a lot of times they get a chance to meet and talk with me. And I try to be as open and, you know, I wouldn't say the exact word mentor, but I do love to share my information. And like, I kind of have a real open policy about, this is what I did, or this was a big hurdle for me, or this is something that I smashed my head up against the wall and barely survived from. And so I try to share my experiences. And so now we have about 7 venues that have opened up in 7 years. Almost every year, somebody leaves and opens up something, from like a fashion store to a pop-up shop thing to a retail stores to other co-working spaces. XY Atelier was an intern, and Paulette and 3 of the members, they all met and they opened up a co-working space, fashion space, store, and a gallery now. So they've expanded. We've had like photo studios open up. Kira is a member and opened up a photo studio. We've had people really involved, like, and even just like people who are like part of the community would come by all the time and get to know everyone. And then start like Daryl opened up Holy Red Studios, and Louis B. James is opened by someone who was involved as a member. And I really believe it's being in a space where they're seeing people do like there's a certain fear, like, oh my gosh, this is New York City. I'm tiny. I'm just a little person. I'm not a millionaire. I can't open up a space or a store. And people say like, well, they did it.
Yeah.
Like that's kind of a fight. Like this loser asshole did it. So man, I don't suck as much as he does. So I'm glad I can be an inspiration for them in that way.
It's funny. It is funny though, how everybody continues to inspire each other in the city. The city, I don't know if you've had that moment where you're like, fuck the city, and you wanted to leave. Oh, did you ever have like, that?
Yeah, it's New York. If you don't, you're dumb. No, I mean, yeah, New York is exhausting. I compare it to like being a heroin addict. I haven't ever been addicted to heroin, but I imagine like heroin's this drug that's so awesome, but then it ruins your life. And then like when you're off it, you're like, you know what though?
it's such an amazing,
like,
thing.
Leaving New York is kind of like that. Like, oh my gosh, I'm gonna die if I stay in New York a day longer. And then you're like in the country and like, this is awesome. And then week 2, you're like, screw this, I'm going back to the city.
Yeah, it's weird. Well, I think that what it is, because you have constant hits, constantly. Like every day you can get something and something new, more access, something opens up next to you, some new idea comes flowing through. Yeah, it is. It's crack.
But so anyways, we're expanding. And one of the failures I have as an entrepreneur is that I try to I'm one of those people that like, maybe my job is to build walls and I want to start a wall building company. So as I build my first wall, I stop halfway through. I'm like, I bet I could make a better hammer. So I'll spend like the next 3 weeks figuring out how hammers work and like inventing a new hammer to make my wall building faster. But the truth is like, you know, then I have a half built wall forever where I try to reinvent a hammer. And that's a metaphor for like, I'm always messing with so many aspects of this business that I really shouldn't, that I think we would have really grown a lot, but we built our own private social network. We've like built our own kind of like monetization systems. We have all of our own like inventory tracking systems, art handling systems that we've like slowly built from like, we literally built our own sign-in form for the iPad and stuff like that. You know, we hand build all this stuff just because I use it, other tools, use that software that's out there, and it always just doesn't do what you want. And I'm just one of those people that when it frustrates me, like I'm just like, I'm so tired of this thing not working. So it makes me so angry. I'm like, screw it. All right, where's the programmer?
I gotta say, that's the other funny thing about the whole thing that you've built too, is it's a self-building machine.
It is. It's like
it's one of those things that you can see you'll end up
as a human space. Totally.
Yeah, it's like it's just a 3D printer printing a 3D self. That, like, totally. And the funny thing is that I'm sure this will look, people will look back on this like in history, you know, in like 20 years, you could see like wherever this space is at the time, it is such a weird thing that you've built. You know, you did build a human 3D printer.
Yeah, it is weird. One of my favorite, I have so many little stories from 7 years, but one day we were like putting in a new sign on the front door, and I wanted that glass, the gold glass gilding, you know, like super New York. It's really kind of cheesy New York, but I like New York things that are so New York, like the gold glass gilding name on the front. It's like, I want that. Let's do that for cars. It's kind of funny actually to do it. There's a joke to do gold glass gilding con artist collective. So I started searching into it, and it's expensive as hell. I was like, unbelievable how expensive it was. Like thousands to tens of thousands of dollars were like these quotes I was getting from all these companies. Like, come on, there's like just gluing gold on the window. Why is this so expensive? And I was complaining out loud to like an intern next to me. I was like, man. And then like, why can't I find a reasonable gold glass gilder? And literally someone in the room goes, I do gold glass gilding. And I just turn around and I was like, really? He's like, yeah, that's actually, I'm a sign painter. So gold glass gilding is like one of my top skills. I was like, really? I was like, it's expensive. He's like, yeah, it is expensive, but I'll do it for a good rate. And I was like, I'll even trade. I was like, all right. So it's just one of those funny things. Like that's an example of how the place is like, just say it out loud and someone in the room does it or knows somebody that does it. Or, you know, it's as random as like a gold glass gilder.
Right? Yeah. Well, and the other thing too, is that the funny part is that, and then also the rates tend to be real.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? More reasonable too, because like whenever somebody's,
well, there's a camaraderie amongst creative people too.
Yeah.
Like there's a magician aspect. You know, magicians like only tell other magicians their trick.
Yeah.
Like creative people are kind of the same way. Like you're always really secretive of like how expensive things really are. Cause we all struggle so hard. Like everyone, like there's not an artist in New York who's emerging that's like killing it. Like, you know, even.
And though, also how many people within, I don't know, the first decade really knows their numbers.
Right.
You know, totally. Like, I know how much to charge.
Totally.
Yeah. And that's exactly, I mean, there are this handful of people that kind of like run through, right, because
have the business mentality.
But they're not, they're entrepreneurs that do art,
right,
versus artists that try to do the entrepreneur thing. And it takes a while. I think it takes a while for an artist to realize, just be an entrepreneur. You can do your art, but then you'll know your numbers.
Right.
And then you'll just have someone else take care of the numbers.
Yeah, hopefully.
Like, I just learned that recently. That's why I'm here.
Yeah. That's good. And so, so yeah, there's that kind of aspect to that space that somebody will always have that skill or in the room. And creative people are always, like you said, going to like, kind of like look out for each other and like, actually what I love is someone's like, I do gold glass gilding. I love your drawings. Those are amazing. You draw like that comic book. Oh, I love what you did with that Batman comic. And I saw that. It's like, would you do a drawing for me? I'll trade you gold glass gilding for a cool Batman drawing or something, right? So that's the kind of stuff that kind of happens behind those closed doors that we all can't survive on. But, you know, when you're in a community, you know, people help each other like
well,
that.
Well, yeah, it's funny because like yesterday, Liam comes up and he's like, hey, can I draw on one of your photos? And really? I'm like, yeah, yeah, of course. And then we were like, well, we'll just have other Liam print it.
Right.
You know, and it's all there. Like everything, all your tools.
Yeah.
And it's so hard to explain this to people. I feel like this is like let me ask you this. Where do you see this going? Like what would be, do you have like a vision for it, or are you just letting it kind of grow on its own and do what it does?
Well, so back to like the aspect of it's growing and that metaphor that I keep reinventing all my own tools, which is sort of why I think we haven't, you know, there's a lot of reasons why we haven't maybe grown beyond the one location. I mean, we're actually 3,000 square feet, multiple floors. We have like 800 members.
Sitting in a fucking...
third floor residency program where the artists live. Exactly. So there's a lot of... So we've really grown and grown and grown and grown and grown. But, you know, there's people... WeWork, you know, started 6 months before us. And I think they've like 700 locations, right?
Isn't it considered one of the biggest retail or real estate companies in the world right
now? Totally. Yeah. Exactly. And so, you know, they started like months before us. And I'm like, yay, we got a second apartment on the third floor. We're really killing it. But anyways, I don't compare anyone's success to my own. But, you know, I do think we would have, you know, there's a lot of ideas to grow and I'd like to. And now we're looking at another city and we've got, and that's becoming very real. It's a very, very likely to happen. But what I see is like the world domination view of what we would like to do is I actually really think part of like the whole concept of like creating community and all stuff is to fix a problem. Like, you know, like, that's where I go back to some of the things that Steve Jobs says, and I keep kind of quoting him today, even though he isn't necessarily a total hero. I look up to all kinds of really creative people who say really inspiring things. And one of the things he kind of says the best is to create solutions for problems that people don't really even know was a problem, you know? And one that we all know and we talk about, but no one really is creating solutions for is the fact that like creative people, emerging artists, emerging people, there isn't an early career path. Like it's really the early career path is literally starving artist, right? It's literally you will die almost. Like you're going to starve. And it isn't like starving plumber.
And it's also you're watching your friends take on gigs and slowly drop out.
Right.
That's totally. Part of the starving artist. It's like, oh shit, another one down. Another one down. Oh
yeah,
shit.
Everyone
another
just
one
kind down. Of drops into these like more corporate kind of, or you know, what takes on more traditional jobs or give up really is a big sad aspect to it. And the truth is I think that's a major bummer to the career path. And part of it is I think that we need to revolutionize.
That's,
exactly. That's what we need to do. And or that's what I'm always trying to do, right? Reinvent the new word, actually. That's totally what I would do. I'd sit for an hour at a podcast trying to reinvent a word instead of just have the podcast. And so anyways, the career path, and that's really what I think we're trying to do is like, how do we create those early steps for a creative person to be able to remove all those massive barriers that usually exist and create systems in place so that people can start as a creative career. And it's like this. And so, and hopefully, I mean, I can't wait till we're mimicked, you know, if we do it right, you know, if we're doing it right and we're solving it right in our solution, I really think everyone's going to be like, kind of like the iPhone. If you look, go back to the iPhone design, like every phone is sort of kind of an iPhone now.
Oh, yeah, right? Totally. Weren't they suing people? Because yeah. It was like, oh, glass screen. oh, that's ours. Like, and you totally get it, though, too. Totally. Right before this, I met with a client and I was like, listen, you actually want to have competitors. Like, they're not competitors. They're just, you want to become friends with them because some of the stuff that you're doing, it's not really someone, you might have someone come in and want to work with you. But you need them to go to someone else because they're not right for you.
Right.
You know, and they'll have somebody that will be right for you. Like, totally. If society or culture is going to continue forward, I mean, it's going to continue forward, but if it's going to go towards something a little bit more joyful, I think it's part where it's like, you know who else is doing similar to what you're doing and you're kind of like, awesome, that's cool.
Right.
Because there's still enough difference with your work and their work that your clients can move around.
Yeah, and I think that's, you know, there's all these, like, again, going back to politics, capitalism, socialism, communism, all this kind of stuff. And I think one of the beauties of that we believe in and has been kind of true is that capitalism actually is, like, we kind of, competition's sort of good. Like, this idea, like, oh, hey, you know, it's good to have other people. Actually, it's literally against the law to not have competition, right? Monopolies are illegal. And but anyways, back to the iPhone design is like, it was kind of all phones are iPhones. And in that same way, I kind of think if we can solve this problem of creating a way that creative people can have the community, the tools, the systems in place to really begin their personal career, then I think lots of people are going to like, oh, I got my I know how to do it my way, or here's my take on that. recipe, right? And but really what I really think we can do is if we can start opening up multiple locations, continue to grow that, we can really create this tool. And then it, and at that point, what I think we are is we're the place that a lot of creative emerging people, like if you're an emerging creative, if you're beginning your creative career, we're a way to do it, you know? And so I really think that at that point, whether it's, you know, we've talked with people, I've sat in entrepreneur, I went to an entrepreneur program for like 6 months and was meeting like people on like, you know, billion-dollar companies and stuff. And, you know, like what, like, is it franchise? Is it, how is it done? But, I really think it's, you know, what we can do is we can create that, hopefully it's that system, you know, and I think that that's where our big value, that's the thing, that's the solution for society that we're trying to basically invent. And I want that solution because I think it makes the world a better place. You know, I mean, I think there's business sense about it. I think like there can be money to be made. I'm not anti making money. Yeah. I'm not an anarchist in that way. And, so I think it's awesome to have a business concept. You can go to investors and say, hey, you're going to make money by making the world a better place. You know,
this is the thing that, okay, so by coming into this space, right, it made me, you know, I have this brand and this photography and I've got all this stuff. And then I get in there and I'm like, something's just off. And then as I'm sitting there, I realize like I'm having a lot of conversations about people's like business and their branding and their marketing. I'm like, oh shit, this is something I do. So then I started hitting up some people that I've been talking to about before. So I ended up, that was the meeting that I had before. It was literally just about branding and marketing. And one of the things that she was talking about is like money. I'm like, we're not going to talk about money. I don't want to talk about money because I will sit down with you and we will have a blueprint to hundreds of revenue streams. But what we really need to focus on is how you're going to empower the world. Let's just focus on that. Right. And it's such an interesting business that she has. It's like a completely, it's a dominatrix who is really a healer, but she is stuck under this. It's like, don't talk about money. Don't talk about that stuff. Let's talk about what you're actually doing, which is healing. Right. You know, you're working with people to get them to like deal with their stuff. And I think that's the funny new thing, because the other night Samia, is that her name? Samia. Mm-hmm. Yeah, was in, who I'll be bringing onto my podcast as well, where, you know, she's helping kids like, hey, by the way, it's not about the money. You can make money, but it's really about empowering each other.
Right.
Which I don't know if that would be considered, you know, it's hybrid capitalism, socialism, right, anarchism, communism. Right. You know, it's kind of this new thing that there's nothing, no one person has this theory. It's the theory is just self-evolving and putting its hands through different people.
I've been talking about the new bohemianism, right? And I like this idea of like, there's a, sort of this culture that of, to me, what I see of millennials that's getting really popular, and I'm a huge supporter of the concept. And that is like, there's a lot of like, bohemianism, the old idea, or a lot of the old 70s and 60s kind of ideas of like, tune out, drop out, right? Don't engage in the system. The system, and there's a lot of reasons not to, right? But that was sort of like, it's like fight, rebel, create your own community, create your own new society. Let's live in an utopian idea. And I think all that's really beautiful. As a new bohemianism, which is like, it isn't dropout. It's like the system's there. There's probably not going to be changing it. Money exists. There isn't going to be removing the idea of money probably. Let's just change the way we think about it. Like, it's like money doesn't mean it. We know it doesn't mean anything. And so let's treat it like it doesn't mean anything in that way and treat it like what it is. Money is like fuel for your car. It's not like, you know, like, it's not like everything is about getting fuel and massing as much fuel, because it's meaningless. It doesn't mean, like, what? Why do you want fuel? Because you want to drive your car. Where do you want your car to go? You want it to go there. Well, that's how much. Then let's figure out, after we're done figuring out what are you driving and how far do you want to go, then you figure out what the fuel you need to get there, right? And that's the money aspect. And so I think the new bohemianism, they're not valuing money. They just, and they're not dropping out. They're just thinking about, all right, it's not about that thing. It's not about the money. It's not about the fuel. It's about the destination. And then now these are just things I know that I have to engage in probably to get there.
Yeah. And it's also redesigning the actual vehicle to get to that destination as well. And I think it's interesting because you brought up Tim Leary's quote. So Tim's son, Zach, is on the same network that this podcast, Artist Decoded, is on, and the mine and everything.
I love Timothy Leary.
Yeah.
He's like, for me, in college, that was the first person that I got addicted. I started reading all his books for fun, you know?
Yeah.
Anyways.
Yeah, no, he's great. And it's funny because like this network that we're on is based off of Ram Dass in this you know, that whole spiritual world, right? And what's interesting is that Tim, that comment, tune in, turn on, drop out,
right?
People had that, so like a lot of people from mainstream world got that wrong. You know, what he was really saying, right, is like, hey, drop out of the bullshittery,
right?
But tune in to like this deeper thing,
right?
And then, but one of the things that's really interesting too is this other big quote is find the others,
right?
And I think that's where it's interesting, is that a collective space is where you can find the others,
right?
So isn't it also bizarre that something from 40 years ago, you know, this him and a handful of other ones, where they're just like, the system's fucked and it's gonna change, and then right. It's like it took a generation to kind of filter through it, but it's now it's happening, and it's almost bizarre how fast it's happening too.
Well, I think there's just these ideas that have been around forever, you know, like there's a certain spirituality to where those ideas are coming from, you know, and I think like it's always being, those ideas are always being recycled, and really, because all it really is, it's just about humans, like everything we build, like these microphones, this computer, this recording device, right? This podcast is just so like we can talk to each other, kind of, you know, or I can share something. And these are, these devices are just built to like make better, right? Technology is usually, oh, let's solve a problem. But technology often creates new problems. And sometimes those new problems are worse than the problems they might be solving, right? And that's the problem of like consistent growth, maybe, or this idea of this, like, and that's one of the things that's scary that I'm not against, I personally don't support about America, is like, or even like, again, to bring up Trump again, like, we need to go back to being productive, and we need to go back to like making things, like, you know, and I like the sentiment, I guess, but really, is like, do we really need to like make our cars go faster always? Do I always need my cell phone to have a faster processor? Do we, like, sometimes this desire to make things always better goes against, or can break the whole reason we made it to begin with,
yeah,
the technology to begin with, because really all of it is about the idea, and we get so caught up in life and society and money and all the things that we forget don't really mean anything. And so that's why like Timothy Leary or these like basically these like spiritual gurus thankfully appear in the world, I think, when we need them, and they just say the same thing they've been saying for tens of thousands of years, like, yo, it's about the people, stop worrying about the bullshit, right? The other stuff that's like that's like getting in our way, the all the stuff that we think is making our life better. Kind of like the first guy who, like, someone invented fire, and there's some old guy sitting around the fire pit, he's like, this is gonna bring problems. You know, just you wait. I don't know. Remember before fire?
I just like that. I like to go even before that. I like the monkey that was sitting right next to the other monkey that took a stick and put it in the tree. Like the first technology of taking a stick inside of a tree and pulling out the ants. And someone's like, oh, that's not going to be good.
Right. That's like, why don't you just use your tongue like the rest of us? Why do you need this new tool?
Oh, God. Did you see what they're doing? Did you see what these kids are doing? They got sticks and they're putting them in the trees and they've got these ants and they're licking them off. And you know what? He was kind of right.
Yeah, totally.
He was totally right.
Yeah,
you should have stopped that when you had a chance.
But I mean, but then, like, I'm you know, as a person, I'm like, one of the things I liked, again, like, to keep talking about Timothy Leary, because I can talk about him all the time, one of the things I loved is he was such an eternal optimist about everything, that like, he's like, that's going to ruin the world, but the new world that's going to come out of the ruins is going to be amazing.
Right? Well, I think that's how a lot of us are. I think if you're like a spiritually tuned in person, like, that's kind of how it is. It's like, yeah, this sucks, isn't it fucking awesome?
Right,
because you end up like walking into it and you know you kind of look at the drama. It's like when Trump is elected, right. There was like a handful of us, like, I put it on my podcast, like one of my intros immediately, and then I listened to Douglas Rushkoff. He released one like one or two days later. It's the same, almost the same intro, which is like, hey, this is fucking awesome. And we're both not Trump guys. We're like, this is what's great about it, is that he just wants to get credit for anything. So let's just make whatever the fuck we want, put his name on it, and we got like fucking flying cars.
Right.
Like we have no government to stop us. Like, yeah, it's like, would you be willing to have clean water and fresh air and a Hyperloop? But it just had to have the word Trump on it. Be like, yeah, if we want to rebrand Trump and right. be like, Trump is like UL, you know, like no one never like looks at their power cord and right. like freaks out, because at one point, let's just give fucking who cares, man. Like if we want to like create a culture, a society or a system that ends up bringing people together in love and unity and right. equality, but we call that Trumpism, it's like,
let's just call it Trumpism.
Yeah. And it's like, just totally take his name from him. It's like, right. it's the same thing as Nazis taking swastikas or, you know, like any of this stuff. It's like, we're just
so hard not to just compare, bring up Nazi.
Right. But it's like the opposite. It's almost like right. somebody tagged me in something on Facebook. It was one of my friends, in the UK, and he tagged me, and like he's wants to repurpose the Confederate flag, and it's like, I know you're not here anymore, but like we still have these like race issues here,
right?
And like I don't think you see it, like it's like a black dude that's doing this thing, like in the US, it's like don't do that, don't tag me in a Confederate flag. But imagine if we repurpose the Confederate flag mm-hmm. into something positive.
Yeah, I mean, I think there's obviously the historical times when people in societies take words and rebrand them and things, and I think it's awesome, and I think it's part of the healing, right, to do that kind of stuff. But yeah, Trump, I still don't know how. I think it would take me a long time to like to call something like this Trump water tastes good. It will always be a bitter taste in my mouth. No,
I think our generation, the people
I know what you mean,
at a certain element, like we're gonna be like, because I think about the two. Think about these kids that are born right now that, like I did the shoot the other day, and it's like the model was like the 16-year-old kid, right? And like her worldview versus all of us adults, it's like, damn, that is weird. Like you're on your Snapchat, like you're on apps. What the fuck is this house party app right. that you guys are all addicted to? Like it's crazy. But then once Oculus Rift and these other come along, she's gonna feel like an old lady.
Yeah,
like totally. Just like all of us, and like remember when you were on Snapchat?
Totally. That's right.
So I think that like we'll, you know, she's part of our generation, and the rest are part of this like, oh, Trump water. But those kids, let's just give them the best fucking Trump water they could ever have.
Totally. I actually watched this little baby, like I was at Midtown, I saw this like little, like just waddly baby, I guess, so like two, you know, just barely walking, walk up to a big TV screen and start swiping it and look back at this mom and, like, confused, like, this screen's broken. You know, like, I was like, man, that's to me is just like the sign of, like, it's amazing how far ahead always, like, the kids are with technology. This little baby swiping at the screen and, like, just assumes it's broken because it's not interacting with his
yeah.
swipe.
It hit me on that shoot. It was like, holy shit, we are fucking dinosaurs. You know what I mean? Like, you know how for the longest time, like, you know, those kids won't even know what it's like to run outside and play in the grass. And then it's just like, that's what a dinosaur would say. Time to move on, fuckers. Like, let's stop talking about how long it took us to walk to school in the snow.
But like, I mean, I actually love, like, right when Pokemon Go came out, I downloaded it and was playing it. You know, I'm in my 40s, and everyone I know is just looking at me and laughing. And it's actually embarrassing. Like, I was playing it and walking around, and I'd end up on a street, you know, like the first couple of weeks, I'd be on a corner and I'd look around, there's like 70 other kids between the age of 9 and 13 and a few parents standing.
I like that you just said the keyword. You said 70 other kids, like you immediately became the we, like we're just a bunch of kids, because it's true, we're all kids. We are all stuck between the ages of 7 to 17. Like you're in your 40s, I'm in my late 30s, right? I don't, in my mind, it's like I know my body says that I'm in my late 30s, well, in the way I've taken care of, like maybe my mid 40s, but don't you feel like you're a fucking kid?
Yeah, I mean, I that's one of the jokes I say, that people are like, oh, how have you done all these things? I'm like, oh, because I refuse to grow up. I refuse to, like, go get a job.
Fucking Toys R Us kid.
I mean, that's not totally true. I mean, sometimes I get really mad at myself. I'm like, I really need to be more mature.
Yeah.
But so, yeah, I'm standing out there, and I'm, like, embarrassed playing Pokemon Go, but I loved doing it. And I loved that because what blew, and we already all know this, but I was like, holy crap, this is finally, because I'm such a big on, I love trying the new things and seeing what people are doing stuff. And someone listened to the song or watch this app or download this new thing. And I was like, man, augmented reality is here. We've been talking about forever. This is it. Looking around, I'm like, we're all augmenting reality right now.
And it's just you like, and all your 10-year-old yeah, friends.
Totally all. And I was like, this is awesome. And I kind of want to run and high-five everyone. And I'm like, and they're like, what are you talking about? This is just Pokemon. I'm like, no, this is the future.
This is
augmented reality, and it's working, and we're all just doing it. And we're not even like thinking, I'm augmenting reality right now. This is just like,
and it's not as crazy as we thought it was going to be.
Yeah, totally. And it's sort of like when the first screens were projecting, like, I can imagine someone was trying to sell that idea to someone like, this, so there's going to be this radio wave in the air, and it's going to send a signal to the screen, and I'm going to be able to like have a camera, and you're going to be able to watch me talk anywhere in the can broadcast this thing. And people are like talking about television networks. And if you hadn't seen, like, that's crazy. No one's going to understand what that is. And then finally, when people just turn on their television, sat in front of them, like, oh, this is simple, but this is awesome. This is a whole new world, right? Like, I love how, again, after I've just talked about Timothy Lear and like, fuck technology, drop out. I'm like, well, technology is awesome.
No, that's the thing. It's also how we look at it, because we do get stuck, and we end up, it's like how we view it. And that's the trip, you know, it's like, oh, I was looking at this thing as like this terrible, awful thing. But actually, that's just my perception of it. And it's also funny how this all sneaks up on us, because, you know, like you said, we all of a sudden have augmented reality, and you woke up and you're like, holy shit, I didn't even realize I had this in my hand. And these kids don't even know what the hell they have in their hand, but this is fucking augmented reality.
Right.
Flying cars will be the same goddamn thing.
Right.
Like, all of a sudden you'll be like, holy shit, wait, we're in a flying car. When did this happen?
Yeah, I didn't even really realize that. Yeah,
I didn't even realize I was flying. What?
Well, yeah, well, the next is the self-driving car, right? Self-driving car is going to change cities. Oh, here, without talking a new subject, what do you think? There's so much debate about this, and this is the topic that I'm really excited to talk about. Do you think it will, what's the biggest change to our urban environments or city environments, our rural versus urban or both, the suburban sprawl, the density of populations? How's the self-driving car going to change that? What do you think?
Okay, I have a belief that I think it's going to be, I think the self-driving car is going to connect with the other big thing that's happening right now, which is the green buildings. Mm-hmm. And I think that we're about to flip into that utopian space, like the Matrix type thing, where buildings are all glass, but they're all made of green algae and everything. Right. And I think that the self-driving cars and the fact that we're all in the sharing economy will just like twist over in the next 10 years.
Yeah,
that's how I feel it's going to happen. Super efficient.
I think the efficiency is a big aspect. And actually, like, what's that new carbon something or other that they put on glass, and now all glass is actually a solar panel as well. And so all these buildings are just going to be covered in solar panels, and they'll actually generate more energy than they. Elon Musk is a huge fan of this stuff. And
take that, T-Dog. T-Dog glass.
I love Elon Musk.
No, I'm talking about the other one that we're giving credit for everything to. This is going to be called Trump glass.
That's right. T-Dog glass.
Yeah.
Exactly. But because he's like, I will not approve the regulations unless it's called Trump glass.
Yeah. That's it. And then be like, fine. Okay. Call Trump glass.
But
we can cut it out when he dies. We'll take his name off everything.
I think it will change. Again, it's going to continue the push towards urban living. Because a lot of times, I really think the reason why we live in suburbs and rural areas, there are some people who love just being away from people. Like, some people really, and a lot of people do. And there's a lot of advantages to it, to like having a big yard and like not ever seeing your neighbors ever. And there's a nice solitude in that. Yeah.
I love visiting my friends in Pasadena. I'm so upset. My friends Cora and Duncan are moving to New York, and I'm losing their place. You know what I mean? It's like, I'm losing their place because they're moving, and they're like on top of the hill in Pasadena. Uber drivers can't even find their way up there. It's perfect, and I'm losing this goddamn space.
But I actually also think a lot of people just do it because it's cheaper, and like, you know, I'm like, all right, well, how much of a commute can I handle? And I actually think there's going to be a massive, since commutes are meaningless soon, you know, how do I spend 30 minutes in a car or 5 hours in a car? It doesn't matter. I'm just on my laptop the whole time. You know, I think that our office. Actually, I almost think like the car will be our office. And when we're not in our car, we're not in that self-driving cars or the car subscriptions that we're part of, we're actually just connecting with people and we're at our meetings and all this kind of stuff. And that actually, like our desk will be that kind of car. And I actually
think our desk will be VR.
And yeah, exactly. And I think I think where we live will be much less important.
Totally, so, absolutely.
You know, we'll just live where we want to a little bit more. I think it gives us a little more freedom. And I think that will create density because I think a lot of people will realize, I don't want a car. I don't, like, I've got my self-driving car office, but other than that, I want to walk to the grocery store. I don't want to walk to my coffee shops. And I want to walk, I think we're going to have a new... a denser suburban, like, I don't know if it's going to be like the towers of China kind of living.
It'll be like downtown areas will pop up again, yeah, become more
like
of a thing.
The suburban density will just get tighter. And we're going to have, I think that's a really interesting subject is think like how our city is going to change. And I actually think some people are like, oh man, our city is going to get murdered by self-driving cars because we're all going to move out because we won't need to be there because we can drive as far as we want. You know, our car will drive us home for 2-hour commute. It doesn't really matter. It doesn't feel like a 2-hour commute because I'm on the phone.
And there's going to be people that'll do that, but I don't think it's going to be the majority of the people.
Yeah. And I think it's because since we can live wherever we want, people are going to prefer to live in places that are easier to live.
Well, I think also what will happen is that cities will end up becoming their own special fun houses.
Right.
You know what I mean? Because it's just going to be some communities are going to get taken over by a certain kind of people. And then it's like, hey, this place is fucking awesome. You know, like everyone will be its own little culture where it's right. And there'll be a little sampling. Because right now it's like you have to go to Portland or for weird.
Right.
You know, or you have to go to Austin. You know, there's these, every city has this little flavor, right, but it'll
soon be Trump will make all cities that are the Trumpville and Trumplahoma. Well, Truhio.
You've been by the Trump. What if we all just started pretending that he's in the Truman Show, like the Trumpin Show, and we all just started like, actually, this is all just a show, man. Like, really give him that, like, psychedelic, psychological thriller for himself. No, anyway, you've been to the Trump thing on the West Side. Mm-hmm. Like, that place is just weird as fuck. Yeah. But, yeah. Yeah. That's what it's going to turn into for... Yeah. We got to wrap this up.
I was going to actually say, do we have bathroom break, actually?
Well, I was going to say, we should wrap this really soon. We went over time.
How about let's... Can you pause?
Yeah.
Is it really funny? Because I actually have to go really bad.
Okay. Okay. Yeah.
And no.
His are 3 hours long and people will just like break in the middle. But then I heard about it, why he does that too, is because, and I noticed this after people, for a lot of people, after they go to the bathroom, they come back and they're like, okay, now they are more relaxed. Yeah. To talk about. But they were like holding this fake persona like through the whole thing, you know? And then all of a sudden like, fuck it. This is true.
It's like, okay. Oh, you know what? Actually, the stuff that I said bothered me doesn't bother me actually.
Yeah. There's a thing with shoots too, where like after the first look, after the model goes to change and she goes to the bathroom, it's like everything all of a sudden gets good. Really? You know, like, it's like, get rid of the first look. The first look or two is like terrible.
That's right. Cause you actually do like the fashion is like a big aspect of your.
Yeah. I'm not just running around shooting like kids for like, like, it's like, no, this is a thing. Mm-hmm. This is work. Right. Yeah. But it's like that helps like get rid of the whole thing, the pressure for someone's like going to the bathroom. Cause also I think it's like time in the mirror. You know, you go and look in the mirror and you look at yourself and you're like, okay, I'm cool. You know what I mean? Like, there's like a little bit of me time, a little check time.
Yeah.
Good luck editing this, Yoshino. So yeah, we should wrap this up. Do you want to give people, what would you like to tell about the site they can go to or like?
Sure. Well, I mean, anyone can always learn more about Conartist Collective at conartistnyc.com, which is sort of like our public facing website. So it's conartistnyc. Because ideally we'd have multiple cities and we'd be able to have different sites for each. And so you can learn, but as we only have one, that's sort of our site. And that's kind of our public facing site. And there's a lot of information on there. You kind of have to click around. And I think it's kind of fun because there's so much. We've been around for 7 years and there's so much on our website. That you can just sort of learn by just seeing all, like, you know, one of the 700. Well, actually we've done like 170 or 190 shows or something like that, or events. And then, but then also you can join the collective at carnivorouscollective.com. There's a bunch of links in there so you don't have to remember, but it's $5 a month to join. And there's a virtual membership. And people are like, oh, I'm only a virtual member. But we actually don't distinguish, like, you're a member or you're not a member. And when you're a member, you can do everything that has to do with being a member of the collective, which is add subscriptions or be part of other things and all this stuff. Some of that stuff may be monetized. In other words, there could be additional costs, you know, but what's great is, like, you can choose to do it or not. I like to say, like, when you're on a sports team, like, that doesn't mean that every field that you play at is free. You might have a game and it's going to be at Chelsea Piers and there's going to be like a $10 greens fee that day, you know, whatever, you know, to play on that field. But in that way, like, things are monetized individually, like the workspaces or the art store or the art fairs or all the kinds of different stuff, if you want to be involved or not. But once you're a member and you can involve with everything. And you can find all that information online. And it is a really huge community to, like, connect with. And actually, with the tools that were built, the private social network tools we're building or we built that are been, we've worked for years, we've got some massive updates coming. You'll be able to download it as an app, hopefully before 2017 even. And we've got a whole new kind of, like, way you log in. And so again, we're just building, continuing to grow these things that our members use to make it easier and better for them to do what they want to do or the reason why they even get involved.
And there's, like, the forum and everything like that. And then could you talk about, like, the memberships on the, like, for the people here that are here in New York?
Yeah, well, I mean, for people in New York City, so we have people all over the world who are members of the collective and really active. Even, like, Sampo is in Japan and he's still in almost every show and he's really involved with all these discussions. And I haven't seen him in years, sadly. We miss him. But yeah, so it's a virtual tool, the forum, a calendar. I mean, it basically is a private social network. It's sort of like, imagine a Facebook kind of, you know, hopefully it looks a lot better than Facebook, but imagine Facebook, but instead of seeing your aunt's sandwich and a bunch of comments about it, it's like, hey, here's an art opportunity and here's a discussion about it, right? So, you know, there's a forum. And unlike how social networks usually work, where you kind of follow a person, and like, hey, I follow my aunt and whatever my aunt posts, that's what's in my feed. You follow ideas or you follow projects and things. And so, oh, you don't necessarily follow a person, you follow the things going on. So I either get notifications of the stuff I'm interested in or not, depending upon what I'm following, right? So that's basically a private social network. But really, it's just a tool to allow creative people to be active. And yeah, you know, share information is a big part of it. And the community aspect is a big part of it. But really, most people use it to be in art shows, to be in exhibitions, to be in projects, to be part of a publication coming out, to share articles, to find work, to find roommates, to, you know, I mean, it's a, just a tool to be active in your creative pursuits.
Yeah. And then if people want to join in the city, you have different tiered options for that
too. Yeah, and then the workspace. So then another thing, the collective basically operates the co-working space. And we're pretty known for that, but we're so much bigger than just the venue. But the co-working space is the 3,000 square foot Ludlow location, 119 Ludlow. We've been there for 7 years, actually. And we have, like, yeah, a bunch of tiers about, so if you need a place to work, it's 14 an hour, 35 a day, 99 a week. So you can just come in and pay for one day. We see you once a year. You can come in or not, or never. It doesn't even matter. But you can come in and just don't have any obligation. There's tons of screen printing presses, you mentioned, photo studio equipment. There's a wood shop. There's tools. There's desks. There's scanners and software and all your Adobe programs and all that kind of stuff. Community, weird discussions to get involved in while you're here, which we talked about. But you can also sign up for monthly plans. So if you're looking for a workspace, you know, if you're looking for a co-working space or place to work, regularly, we have a 129, 199, and 249 are different access plans. And so depending upon how much you need to access the space, from like just one day a week to unlimited 24-hour access, you press a button on your phone and the door unlocks. And 365 days a year, you basically have a key to go in and out of the space. We have all different kinds of options, plus storage, offsite storage. We work with other companies that, like, will hang whatever or show whatever. And I keep talking about art in this physical object sense. Like, they'll hang your art, your painting in a gallery. But there's also, like, people will build, you know, like, MakerBot type things and stuff. And, like, it can be very much a makerspace. So there's all kinds of ways to be active, even in the venue. You know,
it's crazy.
It is. It's kind of all over the place. But it's rad. And that's what I love is, like, I feel like creative people... Here's another thing, and there's a quote. There's actually a really famous person who said this, and this is actually kind of a fun way to end, I think. Like, photography was inspired by painting at the beginning. And then painting in turn ended up being inspired by photographs. Like painting today is now photography. You paint from a photo. When photography at the beginning used to inspire, like people used to take photos because it looked like the painting, right? You know, it's weird how like the technology and the way we looked at that technology changed everything. And so a photographer inspires a painter, the painter inspires the programmer inspires the designer inspires the textile fashion designer who inspires the person who's making an app for it, you know, who inspires the person who's then making the tools for the app builders. You know, it's amazing. And so just being in the space, you know, people, it's crazy how the person who's building a new type of LED screen in the corner and theorizing on like what servo or electronic voltage to consider, and through all that can inspire in the same time, in the same room, through everyone, the person painting a picture of a dog in the other corner or something, or, you know, and so that kind of connectivity between people is really what it's all about. And that's what Con Artist Collective is. It's, you know, connecting artists or connecting creative pursuits.
I think it's great, man. I think it's great what you made. So cool. Good job to you.
Yeah. Well, thank you.
Yeah. Thanks everyone. Bye.
Thanks for listening.